All right, welcome to this week's edition of Justice HQ's Think Tank. If you are looking for tangible tips to scale up your practice and the mindset you're going to need to do it, please hit subscribe. Every week, I interview a new lawyer who has successfully implemented the strategies they're going to talk to you about to scale up their own practice. And this week, this man obviously needs no introduction, but we have Arash Homampour. And he's going to talk to you today about how he built his own firm, how he gets the mindset to go out there and get those eight-figure verdicts that us smaller trial attorneys can only dream about having in our lifetime. Arash, thank you so much for taking the time to be here. I appreciate you being so flexible with me.
Of course, it's my pleasure.
And thank you so much for having that that truly enlightening prep phone call, because after that I was like, man, I am so excited to share with everyone, not only in JHQ, but you know, in the YouTube ether, all of the things that you have done, because you obviously know what you're doing. So to start off with, would you mind telling people how they can best contact you if they have any questions after today's Think Tank?
Sure. Anyone can text me on my cell phone, 323-252-7921. That's the best way. Or email me at arash@homampour.com. If you have any question about anything, life, practice of law, you need a sample, you don't know what to do, whatever it is, text me if I'm available. I always try and answer anyone's questions and help people, because I always say that I get just as much out of it as they think they get out of the interaction with me. So
that's awesome. That's awesome. So one of the things that I was very interested in when you and I spoke on Friday was how you got started, because you had mentioned that you basically joined the solo practitioner world trial by fire.
Right.
Right. You didn't have any other choice. So maybe you would, you know, care to share that story with everyone who's watching.
Well, you know, just very bright human being, but never engaged. So I kind of winged everything. High school, winged it, crammed. College, winged it, crammed. Partied a lot, had a lot of fun. Law school, almost got kicked out for sneaking in beer in the library. You know, just lived my life. Wasn't really engaged at all until maybe the first year of being a lawyer, but I had to work in law school and in college because we were very poor. I didn't have parents to pay for anything. I had to use student loans. I had to work almost 30 hours a week the entire time in college and in law school. And so by the time I got to law school, I found a job at a law firm working for this attorney who had been a retired judge, who really wanted to stay retired and had a PI practice consisting of dog bites, car accidents, slip and falls, all small, all let's say, you know, $5,000 to $20,000 cases. And because he wanted to relax and because I wanted to learn, it was a perfect opportunity because I literally learned the practice of PI law while going to law school because I had zero guidance, no direction. And then I didn't want to let the clients down because I, you know, cared about these people. So I kind of just learned trial by fire, just started learning depots, discovery, complaints, everything about running a PI practice, running a photocopy machine, interacting with staff. I was basically a paralegal, but running the office to some extent in the cases. And then I have a humongous ego, super, super confident, but sometimes you actually need to study and prepare for things. So when I took the bar exam, I thought I could wing it. I thought I could do, like, I was the guy in law school that, like, I would ask you for your outline and then do better than you, right? And not prepare at all. But that—
Hey, Brett, can you relate to this at all? Sorry, go ahead.
That approach only takes you so far. So when I, you know, took the bar exam, I failed it. And I was broke.
Was that humbling for you?
Oh my, it was the best experience of my existence was two things: failing the bar, getting divorced. We'll talk about the divorce later. Failing the bar was the best.
I can attest to that.
The failing the bar was the best because it taught me, no matter how much natural, bright talent I have, there is no substitute for preparation. Like, zero, you need to be prepared. So now, like to this day, if I walk in a courtroom, I am overprepared. I know everything. There is winging it, but winging it from a level of knowledge and understanding.
So that's where people say when all else fails, fall back on your preparation. You can always think on your feet and strategize if you're prepared. But was it failing the bar that got you to that point?
Absolutely. I mean,
because I'm trying to figure out how you made it through undergrad and law school, working 30 hours a week and partying at the level you did. Like, I would die.
Well, again, I think if you're smart and bright and pick things up quickly, you can wing it, and you only get so far in life. You know what I mean? Right. You're only living life at 50%. So, I mean, just to cut to the chase, it wasn't until my passion of being a trial lawyer emerged after I became a lawyer that I like became laser focused, super engaged, loved what I did. And it was like kind of like a love affair, but an effortless love affair. But back to the practice. So I didn't pass the bar, had no money, living off my girlfriend, living in her apartment. Her dad was supporting us. It was super humiliating. Studied for the bar, passed it, and then didn't have a job. My uncle was a doctor. He had all these businesses. He was getting in a lot of litigation and lawsuits. He basically said, I'll hire you to work on a piecemeal basis on some of my lawsuits. And then at the same time, my former boss retired. And so he gave me 30 cases. So when I finally passed the bar, graduated, started doing a little work for my uncle, started my own firm doing these small 30 cases. And I tell this story. I remember I settled a case for $60,000, right? A PI case for $60,000. And I thought I was Jay-Z. I thought I was the biggest baller ever. I thought I was like super rich. I would look at my bank account because it had $20,000 in it or whatever. And I was like, I'm loaded. You know what I mean? I'm like, man, because it just, you know, I'm just everyone, like my first big settlement, I was like, oh my God, I'm the boss. I'm gonna take
it. We've all been there.
Right. And I was, you know, basically just doing PI, trying to make a living, live my life. And I went to a CALA seminar and I saw Gary Dordick and I saw some other people and they just totally inspired me. I'm like, who's that cool dude that's successful, powerful, funny, charming, engaging, but a real human? Doesn't occur like a lawyer. You know, when you see Brown Green, you're like, okay, that's a lawyer. Yeah. I'm not that, right?
Right.
You get Dordick, you're like, okay, I'm that. So that totally lit me up, trial practice. And from some moment I said to myself, and I literally thought of it this way, you could sell condos in El Segundo and make a living and you know, $500 to $1 million condos, or you can sell $50 million homes in Beverly Hills and Bel Air. Where do you want to be? You want to sell a bunch of condos? You want to sell a bunch of $2 million homes? Or you want to sell $50 million homes? I wanted always to sell $50 million plus homes. I mean, even today now, $50 million's too low as far as I'm concerned in terms of my abilities and talents. But to get there, no one's going to give you a $50 million case. So basically I said, I started a firm. I had to pay the bills. So I took all the cases I could, like everybody else, to get money in. But I always had the intention of scaling my practice up, not in terms of volume, but in terms of type of case. I said, I'm gonna go to the medium case, then I'm not gonna take anything under X, then I'm gonna go to the larger case, I'm not gonna take anything under Y, and then up and up and up, ultimately with the goal of handling cases worth 5 million or more and not handling anything under that, because the same amount of time you spend on the $1 million case, probably the same amount of time you spend on the $20 million case. And it's just access to those cases. How do you get access to those cases? Results. Take the crazy case no one wants and either take it to trial and get an outlier result or settle it for an amazing amount or get some, you know, sort of appellate opinion that transforms law through that case. Just some big result that gets you on the radar. Because once you get a big verdict, you're on the radar. And then if you continue getting large verdicts, then you have credibility. And then it's a good marketing, you know, resource to have big verdicts. And then the carriers and defendants know and pay you a lot more for your settlements. So
I got to break down some of what you said. because I wrote down three things I want to ask you about.
Sure.
Actually, four things. One of them, and I have to tell you this just on a personal note, because I've met you before. You actually said something to me one time in an event many years ago that I was like, wow. I can't believe you just said that. when you talk about wanting to be like one type of attorney versus another type of attorney, right? What I take that to mean is you want to be the kind of attorney who's cool and relatable, right?
I don't want to be. It's very important. I don't try to be cool and relatable.
You want to be authentic.
No, I'm authentic. I am cool. I am relatable. What we do as lawyers, you know, what we do as lawyers is we adopt a character we think a lawyer should be and add and detract from our own humanity. So what I did is I always wanted to be Arash, literally. There's zero difference between the way I'm talking to you and the way I talk to jurors.
I believe
It's Arash. So yeah. I wanted to be myself. And the reason I'm making that language distinction is I'm not trying to be authentic. I am authentic.
Okay.
But
there's something about you that I think also makes you authentic. It was something that caught my eye. I was like, wow, that dude is cool.
Thank you. Yeah.
Your tattoos.
The other
tattoo. When I saw you, yeah. And I think you and Pejman had actually posted some pictures of like when you guys would get new tattoos.
Right.
And I personally, I mean, I have a few. And at the time that I was thinking about getting them, I saw yours. And I thought, you know what? That guy is cool. I'm not saying you did it to try to be cool. I'm saying you did it because it was authentically you. But it makes you more relatable to me.
Yes. And
I think it's cool.
I've had tattoos since I was 17. So I mean, this wasn't a fad. I've always loved that as a form of expression of art. Ultimately, I don't give a fuck about anything, or, you know, I don't care about, like, is someone going to look at the tattoo? And it's like, whatever. Like, who cares?
Here's honestly, for me, it's been a bigger icebreaker than it's been anything else. I haven't had any bad judgment. But you mentioned something else that I want you to talk about, if you would be so kind.
Sure.
Your confidence.
Mm-hmm.
It's crazy. And the reason I say that is because one thing that people give me feedback about, and one thing I struggle with myself, is confidence. And I kind of feel like, correct me if I'm wrong, that helped you go from somebody you described as being a partier, not totally focused, just getting, you know, by, had goals, but not laser focused. And then when you decided it was go time, your confidence carried you through.
Right.
Would you agree with that?
I would. So, you know, you're either born with confidence or through self-reflection and serious work, you can strip away the bullshit that detracts from your natural innate confidence.
What was it for you?
Well, I mean, so I did a lot of coursework through an organization called Landmark. So Landmark is, if you can Google it, Landmark. Right around the second year of law school, I started doing this program called Landmark. My best friend, Jamie Berenson, who's like a baller partner, work comp female attorney, she's huge in her world. We're best friends in law school, and she goes, Arash, you have to do this thing. And because she said you had to do it, I trusted her and I did it.
Okay.
And essentially, it's a bunch of courses where you look at the blueprint of being human. You kind of get an understanding of what it is to be human, where you have power and control over anything, and no one has power and control over you other than yourself. Every transaction exists, every relationship that exists, parent, child, lover, you have the power. Nothing happens to you. You either allow it, generate it, create it, or manifest it, period. And so when you have an innate sense of confidence, and then you get this sort of blueprint to humanity where you are now purposeful, deliberate, you see things from a point of view where you're not always reactive, and you're making moves on a bigger level, you're supercharged. You walk in a courtroom, it's like there's no match for you other than bad facts. So
me,
doing coursework, self, looking at myself, breaking myself apart, being open to criticism. One, despite my huge ego, I am an open book. I let people criticize me and not get triggered from wives, ex-wives, children, anyone. I take feedback because I'm always willing to learn and realize I'm an idiot. I'm a student of the game at all times. I always have room to grow. So I'm always open for feedback. I think that's really important, is that you're not stuck in your ways and you're open to growing and learning and being more relatable and being more confident. But here's an important thing. To be a lawyer, you need a certain level of intellect and a certain level of intuition. Mm-hmm. If you're a lawyer, you're a freaking smart person, period, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. If you're a smart person and you've got a law degree, you should have a certain level of confidence that got you to where you are, that the only reason you wouldn't be performing to the level of the confidence you should have is because you're in your own way.
Yes.
You either have some yes. small, the way I say it is, everyone has that shitty bullshit chatter in their head, either saying, you're a loser or you're too good. It's either positive or negative. Most people are super negative. Mine is sometimes over the top positive, like, ego based.
Is that good for you?
No. I'm on top of my to-do list is crush, kill ego. Ego, no amigo. I never want to operate from
ego, no amigo. I'm too good or I
think I'm too bad. But here's what I tell people. So I look in the mirror, like I do a lot of hot yoga. So I look in the mirror and I take good care of myself. And I look at myself and I go, you look good today. And then literally a nanosecond later, I'm like, you look like a troll. You should just go hide in your bed, right? None of that is real. That voice right. is just bullshit. The one that says you walk in a room and it's all these hotshot attorneys and you walk in, you're like, I don't belong here or I'm not good enough. All that's just fucking horseshit. Turn the volume down on that negative voice and just be who you declare you're going to be. I don't get nervous in front of anybody. I have zero fear in a courtroom. I've yet to meet a defense attorney, a judge, an expert that in any way makes me nervous. Because you know why? Because
why? I do want to know why.
I don't give a fuck. I really don't. Because I love what I do. I love myself. And it's just not naturally occurring for me to get to even care what about the other person thinking I'm not good enough. So the point is, I think you need to picture that voice in your head that's always there, it's nonstop, and just turn the volume down and then declare and be what you're going to be, period. That's it.
When you say declare and be what you're going to be, what do you mean?
Loving,
give me an example of declaring it.
Loving, kind, I'm here to take a depo to get the truth out of you. I'm here to get the best possible result for my client. This is an injustice. You're selling an unsafe product. You made an unsafe lane change and you destroyed my client's life. And everyone I'm going to enroll in, making sure that my client gets just compensation, breaking things down so it's simple, normal. Talk to a doctor like they're a human. Don't use these sort of formulas read the formulas so you understand somebody else's perspective, but uh-huh. just common sense in every uh-huh. interaction, common sense. Uh-huh. We're like jumping around, but. Hopefully
so,
that.
So would you say that you are confident? You were born with it. It comes natural to you. And you've spent the rest of your time fine tuning that.
Well, and I also have spent a lot of times chipping away my ego that doesn't serve me. So if you met me when I was younger, you'd go, that guy's going to be somebody, but he's an asshole. I was not innately a nice person. I was not hardwired to be a nice person. I was extraordinarily selfish. Like on a really unhealthy level. I once went to a therapist. I remember my wife at that time was like loving, kind, gentle, affectionate, and I wasn't, right? And so I went to a therapist, like, I wanna be more like that. And she goes, here's the deal. You can rewire yourself. Fake it till you make it. Start adopting behaviors where you're kind, loving, gentle, affectionate, and it'll become second nature. And so I basically transformed myself from this egotistical, overconfident, sort of charming, but a little harsh buffoon over time into a genuinely kind, loving, good-hearted, caring, sensitive person, which is who I always was, right? I was born that way. I was my soul and who I was put on this earth was always loving, super sensitive. I'll give you an example.
Hey, you're super sensitive, but you don't get triggered by feedback.
Super sensitive. If I don't plan how to process something, I'll get attacked through emotion. So if I'm watching a commercial that I've not seen before and I'm not ready, it can make me cry in 3 seconds. if I'm ready, my guard is up. You know what I mean? I'm more focused on logic. So my natural state of being is super sensitive. What happened was through my childhood and parents and their own limitations of love and you know, put limitations on my confidence and my affection and my sensitivity and my love. And so over time, I stripped away the effects of my parents and just declared myself to be who I am. And now I am responsible for me. Every moment of every day, if I walk into the elevator, I go, am I going to be a kind, loving person? Or am I going to be, you know, I always use the elevator Uber test. I always try and be kind and loving, but sometimes you get in an Uber, you want to shut it down. I want to dim my light. I don't want my light to be on at all times. So it's like, I literally go, when I walk in the elevator, is my light on? Is my light off? When I get in the Uber, is my light on? Is my light off? That makes sense?
Yeah.
But that constant thinking of who am I being right now? Who am I being? Am I being kind, loving, generous, you know, a good person? And then being that, or am I being a jerk? Am I being petty? Am I being childish? Am I being reactive? Am I being angry? Am I engaging in sort of low level vibrational behavior? You got to see it and then don't let it run you. You got to stop and then go choose to be whoever you declare to be.
See, the way that you're talking and the vocabulary that you're using, because all of what you're talking about, as the GHQ members have heard me say over and over again, is my jam. Like, I study this stuff. I read the books. I listen to the podcast. I have a very healthy respect for somebody who can recognize, you know what? I can do better in these areas, because I don't think people truly value the connection between your personal life and your professional life. If you're a wreck over here, it's not going to bode well for you over here. But you said, you know what, I'm confident, but I'm a jerk, and I've got these areas I can do better. And you went out and sought the resources to make yourself better, which I think speaks volumes for your character, right? Because how many people do we know that they know they have a problem, but they're too afraid to go open that closet and take a look at the skeletons? They don't want to do the work.
It's a no-brainer. It translates to better effectiveness as a lawyer, better
effectiveness
as an employer, as a friend, as a lover, as a child. I mean, the more in love you are with yourself, the more comfortable you are with yourself, the more kind you are to yourself. You know, you have to take care of and respect your vessel, who you are. The more you radiate and the more people want to give you money and give you results and want to listen to you, and you know, and the more you get done. So it's like, really, it's a no-brainer. You know, I'm always to this moment working on myself, always trying to improve.
I think mindset, which is what you're talking about, is so important, especially when you're a litigator, because all you're dealing with are personalities.
Well, and
we are telling people stories.
And then look, everyone here knows this. The amount of shit and stress and individual transactions as trial lawyers who own our firms, right, that we have, or even if you're running a practice at a firm, is insane. It's enough that if a normal human being had to deal with all the stuff, we're like psychologist, financier, photocopier, you know, human resource manager, trial attorney, cleaner upper. We wear so many hats, parents, children, friends, lovers. You know, it could be overwhelming. It could be daunting. And so you need to be able to put all of that in perspective so that you're of value and use to those clients. I mean, at the end of the day, you need to be your best to get the best results for your clients, period. This is a profession. We are professionals. People come to us because they are in a place where they need a professional to help them. We are not selling them clothes. We are not selling them a vacation. We are doing life transformational activities. And so you need to be the best version of you, and you need to get rid of your own personal nonsense so that you can be the best professional for them at the end of the day. They come for you.
Yes, yes. Now, you mentioned that there was a point when you went from, and I understand that, you know, you failed the bar, which was humbling, and you realized, I got to get focused. You mentioned there was a point when you became engaged and you're like, yes, this is for me, this is my passion, and then the work became effortless. Right. When did that happen?
Well, I tried a case as soon as I became a lawyer, and it was against a medium-sized partner, and it was a business litigation dispute, and I'd never tried a case before. I had no idea.
Did you do it alone?
Yeah, I had no idea what I was doing. I just
got your confidence.
I read the Rudder Group inside and out, everything. And I remember the judge who was the judge in the O.J. Simpson trial, the Asian judge, I don't remember his name.
Ito?
Yeah. He looks at me and he winks and he goes, you are really, really good at this. You should keep going. And I was like, all right.
Oh, he gave you a little shot of confidence.
He did. At the end of the trial, he was like, you're really good. You need to
get
this. So I said, all right.
Did that light the pilot for you?
It did. You know why? Because I was a rock star who had not yet been recognized as a rock star. So you may imagine you're in your bathroom and you're singing to your brush and you're like, oh, the world should see how cool I am and I need the adoration.
Which you do because you DJ'd Mardi Gras.
I know, but I'm saying I didn't get that sort of rock star adoration. And so I generated it. I found it as a trial lawyer because I was getting so positive feedback. I was like, okay, maybe not with a guitar, maybe with a suit, I'll get the adoration I really need.
And you did. So that positive feedback, did that obviously make you think that you had found your calling and this was your jam?
Oh yeah. I mean, getting in a courtroom and all, you know, having fun and all those moving parts and justice and then having people recognize you. Oh, I love it. Love, love, love it.
So how do you go from somebody who was barely getting by and partying and all of that to somebody, you know, because to try a case, you and I both know, like the preparation, the level of detail is unreal.
So this is interesting. And I tell people all the time, I'm single right now. And in the back of my head, I'm like, you know, relationships sometimes can be a good thing. Here's my lecture on relationships. If you're a young attorney or in the beginning of your career, be aware of any negative, toxic relationships that are going to take you down. Please.
Did everybody hear that?
Yeah.
I need, because I have been saying, Arash, I've been saying, everyone, you are the sum of the five people you spend the most amount of time with.
Oh, yeah. Any toxic relationship, whether it's your parents, your friends, your cousin, your lover, the dog, any. And toxic meaning they're not serving your higher purpose.
Guys, it came from him.
Cut them out. Cut him out. And so what happened to me was I actually found the love of my life at age 23 in a nightclub while in law school partying. She came up to me, picked me up, and she was ultimately became my wife. She was the key to my success because she took care of me and the house and the family and allowed me to work insane hours without complaints. I mean, we had our deal, you know, she would spend the money that we ultimately started making and she would curated a very fun, loving, you know, amazing life that reached around the world, but she handled 99% of my life requirements so that I could put insane hours in. So if you do have access to a healthy relationship that will support you as a trial lawyer, by all means, nurture it, don't F it up, and put the crazy hours in. But if you have a toxic relationship or you're alone, hallelujah, get rid of the toxic relationship, stay alone, because you're gonna be putting in some insane hours, really insane hours, like working all week, you know, not taking Saturday off, working 24 hours sometimes with these crazy deadlines we got. You know, you got to put in the work, but the relationship allowed me to really put in superhuman hours. And sort of when everyone else is sleeping, I'm still working. I'm like moving ahead much further than I otherwise would have if I was detracted from what I wanted through a toxic relationship. In other words,
Wait, how do you get energy? Because I need like 7 hours of sleep a night. How are you doing this?
I need 8 hours of sleep, but if I'm doing law related stuff like trial, I don't need sleep.
You're talking about go time.
Yeah.
You're talking about trial time.
Oh yeah. But I mean, you have to have sleep, you know, manage your existence so that you have proper sleep, you know, and live a healthy life.
But I already know when trial comes around, I already know I'm going to have a 2 week general malaise period after trial is over.
Yeah.
I know I'm going to need about 2 weeks to recover. because you're not going to sleep during that time. So what you're saying is make sure that the relationships or lack of relationships in your life is healthy.
Right. And you know, it's, let's keep going.
No, I love it because I think that's really important because I mean, everybody who knows me knows that I'm a single mom, right? And that is, and when I was talking to you, I was like, you know, I got to take the phone call when the kids get out of school because they're interrupting me every 10 minutes, right? And you said, I remember those days. So half of my time is spent navigating around that. And one of the things that I learned, you know, from the advice of good friends of mine, like Brett Sachs, was you got to hire. You have to delegate.
Okay, so we're on the exact same wavelength. I was going to interrupt you and say delegation. Okay, here's everyone listen. The worst delegator, right? The worst. I didn't trust anybody. That was 10 years, 15 years ago. Okay. The most important thing I learned to scale my practice up was delegating. Period. You cannot do everything. Look, can you dry? Can you clean and press your shirt? Yeah, but why would you spend 5 hours cleaning and pressing your shirt when you can pay someone $1.50? Literally think of that. Everything in your practice that you can delegate, delegate. Let go, trust people, hire competent people so that you're not delegating to morons, right? But delegate, delegate, delegate. Leave yourself free to do what you do best, period. Now, it's hard because you can't afford it, right?
Yeah.
I can't hire, well, whatever money you make, put it back in the firm. Here's the problem with today. Everyone wants the Gucci belt now, the Hermes belt bag now, or the Mercedes car now, and then they pay for it. No, 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 no. Live a frugal existence. Don't spend a penny on anything. Put it all back into the firm, hire more staff, and get to the place where ultimately you have free time and you can delegate. I can't tell you that I have so many friends who are successful who are burning themselves out because they're not delegating, they're overworked, they're screwing up their family and marriages because they're just not allocating enough time to family time. So yeah, it's going to take time to get there, but you need to have your eye on the ball of, I'm going to delegate, I'm going to hire staff, because I need to have a life outside of law. I need to.
You want to know when I knew it was time to hire?
When?
And the way I looked at it is, especially after talking to other people, was I can't, even if I don't know if I can afford this in 6 months, I can't afford not to.
Right.
And I was working late one night. It was like the fourth night in the row. And my son was like, Mom, and the kids already know that when they at dinner, they'll ask me, do you have a deadline tonight or can we watch an episode of Cobra Kai? Right. And it was like the fourth night, I was stuck in discovery hell. It was like my fourth set of discovery that month. I was like, this is ridiculous. Right. And my son sat at the edge of my bed and he could see like my desk from that angle. And I said, Cody, go to bed. And he goes, but I just love watching you scroll down with that super serious look on your face. And I was like, oh my God, what am I doing? I don't even have time to read him a bed. I can't even put my kid to bed, right? Yeah. I hired right after that. And I learned the lesson at that time. It is better to pay extra for competent help.
Absolutely. Right?
You can find somebody who's younger and you can train them. You got to pray to God. You're doing it you're doing it with the right person. And then after that, the next time it came time to hire, what I was looking for changed significantly. I'm like, no, I want somebody who actually knows what discovery is this time.
Right.
Who actually knows what a pleading is this time. So I don't have to spend the time training her. She already knows what this
and
is.
And redoing what they're doing. Now, I want everyone to understand, all of my staff, you know who they are? Children of immigrants. Some haven't even gone to college. I don't hire fucking Harvard grads. You know who I hire? People who care, right? Typically immigrant kids.
Yes, yes.
Who love what they do.
Yes.
Who love working at the firm, who, you know, take pride in the details. That's who I hire, and we train them. And then, you know, we don't have staff turnover. Most of the people we hire work for us for forever, love working for us. I'm a super nice boss, but delegating and then finding competent people, which doesn't mean—
But you find people who are hungry. It's okay to put the training hours in somebody who's hungry and wants to learn and wants to be there.
Right. Well, and then, you know the difference. They have a brain or they don't. They have class and common sense or they don't. They're good people or they're not. You know, if this is a lazy person that just wants money and is searching the internet all the time. But I mean, like, we don't have time cards. We don't have webcams on everyone. I don't have internet software where I'm checking what they're doing. I actually could care less if people work or don't. I can tell if they do based on the results we're getting, but I don't micromanage. Another thing is, part of delegating is no micromanaging. I don't micromanage my kids and I don't micromanage my staff. I don't have time to get in conflict with everybody over, did you do this or did you do that? So for me, you know, it's kind of a hands-off approach. I have someone running the firm, an attorney.
I was going to ask, maybe you don't have to do that.
Yeah.
If someone's not doing their job, do you have somebody else that can check that person?
Yes, but we don't. We're so cool. We're just not micromanagers. We're just not like that.
You know, and you're still seeing the results you want to see.
Oh, yeah.
What do you credit that to?
Hard work, fear. You know, but I love when we work with co-counsel, you know, they love our staff. They're just like, man, your staff is like, they want to come in our office. They want to see how we file things, our electronic setup. You know, they want to see how we handle everything because we do it right. We do it the right way. And so, and it's a great place to work. I give all my staff, I pay for anything. If they want to take a self-help course, I'll pay for it. Yoga, I pay for it. Health, I pay for it. They need to take a month off for this. I don't care. I'll even give them money to study for the bar. Like, I view my staff as my partners and my family, and I take care of them. And then you get that back because they actually care and take care of you. Because, you know, if you're thinking about it, if you're working on, let's say, $1 million case or a $10 million case, right? And you've got an employee, $50,000, $60,000, whatever employee, right? If they're happy and they're doing their job, just think of how much income and how much of a difference that person can make for your client and for you if you just treat them well. You know, the upside in our world is so amazing. I tell people, like, short of being a drug dealer or a criminal financial person, no one really can make more money consistently with a good heart and a good conscience than trial lawyers. Seriously. Helping people, we've got your financial upside is so huge. If you do this right, and if money is your metric of success, you can make a ton of money.
So let's talk about that, because you said something on the phone that I thought was really interesting. You said you are one case away from financial freedom.
Oh, well, I mean, look, my office overhead is freaking insane. not just from staff. We have 9 attorneys. Yeah, we have like 30 employees. An expert sees my name and they send a bill for $20,000 because they know it's going to get paid and because they know I'll pay it. So our overhead is crazy, crazy, crazy. If I settle a case for $1 million, that's really going to make zero difference in the firm. It'll pay maybe a week of overhead or something. You know what I mean? So yeah, I'm in the business of big whale hunting, and it costs a lot of money to hunt and take those whales down.
But it works, right?
Oh yeah, it works. I love what
I do. So I think what you were telling me when we had talked about it was you were trying to say, if you are a younger solo practitioner, be patient.
Oh, yeah. So
you are one case away from being able to achieve. And we also talked about getting laser focused about what type of firm you want to have and going after that.
So what attorneys don't realize is it's you're one referral away. Your cousin's mechanic's son was run over, lost his leg, unfortunately, or lost his life. You get that referral and you take it and you either partner with a big law firm or do it yourself and you settle that for $5 or $10 million. That referral fee or income is life-changing. How do you get that case? You get that case through marketing. So people don't understand that they've got a base of customers that's untapped in the sense of everyone they know. So what I tell people is create a database. Every single person you know you come in contact with, put their name in the database. Every lawyer, every expert, every potential client, everyone, put it in a database and then send them marketing materials. We do written newsletters. You can go buy a written newsletter with a template You can add your own paragraph. And I don't care if they throw it away. They get it and they throw it away. But what they do is they see your name. It's imprinted in their head. And the next time someone needs a lawyer, they're like, oh, Brett's a cool guy, or Robert's a cool guy, or Jake's a cool guy, or Michelle's a cool gal. They're a lawyer. They're my friend. They'll help you. They call you and you're like, okay, wow, now I have a big case and I can get a great result for the client and get a great result for myself. But that's one case away. I mean, we've had cases where I've given referral fee checks of $5 million. I got a case, handled it for 3 months. Literally 3 months later, I wrote a check to the referring attorney for $5 million. Can you do
that? Because the case was that valuable. But you've also set your threshold at a certain level where people aren't bringing you cases because they know you're not going to accept it unless the damages are that high, right?
Yeah, I love when I do these speaking things and someone's like, oh, I've got this really big case. They've got, you know, like, they need an epidural. And I'm like, sweet. And I'm like, listen, I can't handle that because we're not set up for that. And then I got to refer it out. Yeah.
Okay. But those cases that you get that are typically high in damages like that, do they typically have liability issues?
Oh,
in other words, why bring them to you if there's nothing that requires your expertise?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, the admitted liability, you know, 8-figure cases go to Panache, right? So I'm the one that's getting the guy on meth running across the street, getting hit by the, you know, I get the most difficult cases. Now, I don't mind that. You know why? One, I'm not in it for the money. I've never viewed my practice as a money generator ever. I don't look at cases as how much money am I going to get. We have a threshold because we're built to handle certain type of cases, but it's not about the money. At the end of the day, I think a tough liability, big damage case is more interesting because those are the ones they won't settle and I get to go to trial on and get
out. You take those cases.
Yeah.
When
I think I can win it, I won't take a dumb case.
Yes. Because when we talked about it, you told me, Ashley, don't try stupid cases.
Yes.
It's demoralizing. It'll bring you down. Don't try stupid cases.
No.
So when you evaluate your cases and they have astronomical damages, so they meet your threshold, do you look for an angle where you either, you know what, I think I can win this, or I really believe in this client and I'm going to find a way to win it?
No. No, it's I believe in this case and the client.
Okay.
And those are the best because the defense is so myopic that even up until rebuttal, they
isn't it amazing? They'll find the one thing they think they can win on. Yeah.
And they
ignore all of this.
And they ignore everything else. Like I've gotten their own experts to agree with everything, and they still think they can win at rebuttal, right? And then the verdict comes back and it's like, I told you, like whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's fun.
And then do they typically appeal those large verdicts?
I've got 3 cases on appeal right now with large verdicts.
Or do they try to settle it afterwards?
Well, I mean, but I don't ever take low balls. So, I mean, here's what I tell these defenses.
Do you handle the appeal or do you refer it out to appellate counsel?
We refer it out. But here's what I'll be in the room with the guy, 6 attorneys from Nissan, whatever, right? And this is literally what I tell them. Here's the deal. You guys are thinking, oh, Arsh has spent $1 million on this case and he's going to settle for $1 million because he doesn't want to lose $1 million in cost. And I look at them and I go, I don't care if I lose $1 million in cost. I could give a rat's ass. It's not going to change anything about my existence. But you know what I do care about is the opportunity to get $60 million or $100 million from Nissan and make you pay for it. So if you're thinking in there, I make decisions based on fear, please go tell everybody in there, I don't care. And that's how I live. And I tell them, you can either pay me now or could we lose? Sure. Or let's go to trial and see what happens.
Have you lost $1 million in costs?
Never.
So your fear is that fear isn't even a reality for you.
No, but I have cases where I've spent $1 million on each right now. If I lost those, I'm fine. I don't need to recoup it. Does that make sense?
Because
I spent it already. I don't care. Your relationship with money, right? Like when you're, it's like it's like you're thinking $100,000 is a lot at some point in your life. Then you're thinking $1 million is a lot. Then another point, money's just stupid. It's all ridiculous. Why not make $100 million your exciting amount? Because if you start thinking that way in that world, then you probably will start gravitating towards $100 million transactions. Again, Money is not the metric of success. In no way should anyone walk away from this conversation thinking Arash is enrolling you and making money. That's not it.
No, but you know what I think you are enrolling in?
But if your game is money, fucking think on a bigger scale. Don't think so small.
Well, hold on though, because I think what you're, I don't think they're mutually exclusive. Right. I think what you're saying is go be the best litigator. If litigating is your passion, go be the best litigator, be the most dedicated to your craft, pay attention to the details, and the money will follow. Let's be real. You can say $1 million. If I lose it, I already spent it. I don't care, because you're not going to starve, Arash, right? Because you have the money.
Right.
You have the money because you were good. So you don't make the money your metric for success, but you made your results the metric for success, and therefore the money followed. So you have the $1 million to spend on a case, and you have the money to go invest in the appellate attorney. And because you took the value away from money that way, the money flows because it's abundant to you.
And remember, and I grew up with nothing. When I first started my law firm, I couldn't afford office rent or rent for my house. My wife and I shared a car. We used to eat on the Chevron card. I didn't start with shit, zero, less than zero. And then in terms of cases, I want everyone to understand, I'll say this with all confidence and hopefully don't sound like an egomaniac. I'm getting 20, 30, $60 million results, right?
Yeah.
I need access to cases that are $500 million. Yeah. I could go take the biggest personal injury case, one of these toxic whatever. I could go try it. They're not giving them to me. They should be. But I think I could try and get $500 million, $1 billion against some big corporation. So that's where I'm at. Is like, I think my talents should be used on an even bigger scale in terms of trial law. So if anyone's listening, give me your $1 billion case.
If I get a $1 billion case, it's going to you. Don't worry. especially because I think the trial portion is so important.
And remember, I have a template or a sample for everything. I will answer your questions about anything law related, even life related. I mentor people, I hype people, I hold you accountable to whatever your dream is. 99% of the time I say no to referrals. In fact, I will tell people, I don't want the referral, let me help you for free so you make the money. I'll step in only if I feel I can add value. So we're here to help.
And you are very participatory on the GHQ Slack app. And you've actually responded to me, and I appreciate that very much.
Yeah, you're supposed to tell me more about your airbag case so I can give
you. I will. I love.
Oh, hold on. And then just main plug. I'm starting a DJ artist career right now.
Okay. I think I saw something on social media about this.
Oh, I'm releasing a track. I'm going to start DJing. I'm going to be a cook. My goal is Coachella 2022. For sure.
Yes.
It's happening. Yuma 10th. You will see me there. But go follow me on social media, The Archer. Go to my—
You know what, if you're at Coachella, we are going to caravan as many lawyers down there, and we will be in your crowd cheering you on.
Yeah.
So, and I've personally seen you DJ, and you are very good.
So, well,
I was at that Mardi Gras.
That was a rap DJ that was doing that for the audience. I don't DJ rap, but my genre is house music, so.
Yeah. Okay. But I love it. Don't focus on the money. The money will come. And I feel like part of the reason why the money comes to you is because you don't place that importance on it.
Exactly.
And so it's
a cliche, but it's true. I'm sorry.
I like to come from a place of abundance. Like I don't think I can't afford this. I think of how can I manifest it? How can I generate it? And so far it's happening, right? And
spend your money on experiences, not things. Things are stupid. Cars are stupid. You know, have a certain dress for yourself so that you look professional, feel comfortable in your skin, but don't buy unnecessary baloney that doesn't bring you joy. It's just attachment to things only brings around suffering. Attachment to people, things. What you want to do is make a lot of money so that you can give, which I'm doing. I started a foundation this year with $1 million of my own money, where I'm going to start giving micro grants to other humans who need the money. And then live your life with experiences. Take your kids all over the world, take them to third world countries, take them to Paris, wherever you can afford. One of my favorite vacations was Lake Powell on a houseboat, so I've gone everywhere, but live your life, have a lot of experiences, because then you become a more relatable human when you're in a courtroom.
I love it. I love it. Man, thank you so much for your time today. And everybody has your cell phone so they know where to find you. You guys, thank you so much for tuning in this week. Thank you so much for watching this week's edition of Justice HQ's Think Tank, sending you joy, love, and lots of success this week. Thanks so much, you guys. We'll see you next week. All right, bye.